Hi and welcome everyone. My name is Laura Klinkhammer and like Niamh, I am a PhD student in the Division of Psychiatry at the University of Edinburgh and also co-organizer of the reproducibility section in Edinburgh. I'm very excited to talk to you today about making your work more reproducible. And in this video, we will discuss specifically how you can trace your steps while you're working on your research. So what do we mean by this? We're referring to a tight record keeping of all things related to your research. So that includes everything to do with your research from the initial stages of in which you are thinking about what kind of project you want to do, to minutes from the meetings with your supervisor, to your analysis plans, which is what Niamh discussed in the previous video, and keeping records of your data and all the versions of your data and all the versions of your written sections for your thesis, etc., etc. And particularly to record all the changes to your recipe and all the outcomes while following that recipe. So why should you be bothered with this? Again, there are a lot of benefits for future you. You are, if you keep a tight record of everything you do in your research, you are less likely to make mistakes along the way, for instance, using the wrong version of your data. It will also be easier to remember your decisions and to execute them when you get to that stage. And when you're at the final stage of writing up, it will be easier for you to remember what you did, so it will be easier for you to write up. And of course you do this research you're going to do, you're going to be doing it within a department or a research group, and it will be very helpful for your colleagues as well to have a detailed record of what exactly you've done to produce your work, so they can avoid duplicating some of your work. It will also be very useful for them to know where the most recent versions of your data and your analyses are. And new students and colleagues that join the research group can learn from your progress because they get to see an example recipe really from the beginning stages of your initial project ID to what the output became in the end. So it's very useful for a lot of people in your research group as well. And of course, it's important to realize that your dissertation and your research is a contribution to the field. And transparent research that has detailed record keeping is much easier to understand and evaluate. And the feedback that you will receive will hopefully be more specific and also more helpful for you. So for instance, during a poster presentation, if you're explaining the research you've done in more detail, you can get more specific feedback. And again, others reading your work can learn a lot from your steps. So it's a win-win for all of these people, I think. So how do we go about this? So one is to keep a notebook in which you keep your detailed records. And two is to really consider how to organize your research files. So a lab notebook could take many different forms. And in its most simplistic version, it could just be a Word document in which you could, which you could use like a diary in which you put in entries every time you work on your research. And you could describe what you've done that day and why you've made certain decisions and motivate why you've made certain decisions so that you can always refer back to it and retrace your steps as you go along in the process. And you could decide also to split this notebook up into several parts, so dealing with several aspects of your research. You could have a separate notebook, say, for your project ID formation, and then another notebook for your data and describing the data analysis plans and the versions of your data, etc. And some people would maybe prefer to use pen and paper for this. And another app that's very useful is Notion. That's actually quite a nice app to keep a nice overview of all your notes. And some people might prefer Microsoft OneNote, which should be available to you through your university license as well. So it doesn't really matter which format you use, as long as you have a consistent way of keeping detailed records and you just make yourself sit down and write what you've did today so you can always refer back to that later on. So next we're going to talk about some things you could consider when organizing your files. So I think this is a very typical example of a folder that isn't very organized. And I've definitely had folders like this in my first couple of projects and always regretted it later, because it's very difficult to get a quick overview of which are the most recent versions and which versions you really need to work on. And it just makes you more prone to making mistakes. And also it costs so much time to figure out every time which version is the right one. So it's definitely worth thinking about a structured way of organizing your files. And some things to consider are location, location, location. Try and make designated spaces for different parts of your research, and always make sure to upload the new versions of that aspect or the document to the same location. Don't spread it out over a bunch of different locations on different machines or different folders, because it will just be confusing for you to figure out where the right version of things are. So just stick to one location and always upload to that space. Next is to be consistent in naming files. And another important thing to consider for that is to incorporate essential info. I would recommend doing that both in the file name and in the actual document as well, so that you always know which document you're actually working on. And so things to consider for that could be a quick content description, so data, introduction, or whatever you're working on, a version number, and a date of creation I would put in the file name and also in the document itself. And while you're coming up with a structure like this, just make sure that others can understand your files, because if you make sure that others can understand your files, your future self will be able to understand your files. So, and here's an example that I came up with, an example structure. So here on the left, you see these folders that you could have specific folders for different aspects of your thesis. So you could have a separate folder for your data and a separate folder for your written sections, for instance. And in these in this middle section, where you see the Word documents, I've consistently named the files with the content and the version number and the date of creation. And the same I've done for this column on the right here with the data. And another thing you could think about when organizing your files is to add a README file. So you could consider it to be kind of a small sub-recipe, if you will, for maybe a particular layer in the cake. And it would contain a little bit of extra information of what's in that specific folder. So it could look something like this, just a basic text file with what information is actually in this file. So a file for the data in this thesis on this project and your project title. A note of when it was last updated and by whom, and then a brief description of what is in each of the files. So in version one, it was only 35 participants, the data of 35 participants. Version two actually had all participants and was the raw data. And then version three, you could see it's the clean data and a brief description of what was done to clean this data. Because this will be very helpful if you go back to this folder and you're not entirely sure what was done to each of these files, and also for other people picking up your project or maybe working on some of the same data, it is so, so useful to have this kind of information to read to figure out what's going on in this folder. So would really recommend README files. So these recommendations can be applied to the most basic forms of file organization just on your computer, say in Windows Explorer, for instance. But you could also consider using other tools such as Open Science Framework or GitHub that might facilitate the version control a little bit more. And I would recommend checking with your supervisor first, because they might be familiar with some of these tools already, or maybe some tools are regularly used in the research group already, and they could maybe guide you to what would be most suitable for your project. And also just to double check with them what level of sensitivity your data and your analysis will be added because some of these tools might not be suitable for projects with sensitive data. So just double check with your supervisor on these things and then feel free to explore, of course. So I hope this video was helpful for you in making your steps a little bit more traceable as you go and progress through your research. And I hope to see you in the next video, which is also the last video of the series on transparency. Okay, see you there.